for an Arcadian ideal, we explored the notion of ancient Greece as a centre for youth, energy, toleration, and intellectual freedom. Alexander the Great and his well-trained and coordinated 35,000-strong army spread the art and literature of the Greek culture far beyond the perimeters of the then-known world. And it is through their ideas our desire to capture the essence of style was born. "Oh, Italia," wrote the 19th century rock star poet Lord Byron, "thou hast the fatal gift of beauty. The orphans of the heart must turn to thee." Greek colonists fixed the name Italy on the land they settled, applying it first to the southern Italian peninsula. It was richer in agricultural resources and just right for grazing animals than the lands of Greece. The local natives they mixed with referred it to as Vitellia, the land of cattle. But Italy it became, and the name was applied from the late 2nd century to the whole of the peninsula from the Alps southwards. Long before Rome became the centre of a great empire, it was only a collection of small settlements, founded on seven hills above the river Tiber, whose lofty vantage points acted as a defensive standpoint from invaders and protected its inhabitants from the malaria and other diseases that frequented the marshy valley floor. There was only minimal agricultural flatland for crop cultivation. The Roman gods of the community, such as Jupiter, Mars, Vesta, Janus, and others, were concerned with the welfare of the state, expressed best by the word religio, which meant a feeling of respect and awe towards the sacred. As fertility is synonymous with survival, it doesn't take much imagination for us to endeavour to understand why allusions to everything associated with the act of procreation were given prominence in their art and life, and why they worshipped the goddess of love. If you add this to the fragility of human life in a world without antibiotics or sophisticated surgical techniques, one in which an infected wound, the drinking of contaminated water, or a miscarriage meant certain death, we can begin to understand a little more. The city of Rome came into being when the seven hill towns became one to drain the valley floor and improve their collective future. The construction of the Cloaca Maxima, the great Roman sewer 6 centuries before Christ, meant they could drain the area of low ground southeast of the capital between the Palatine and Equiline Hills, and then markets and other trading activities could take place on the reclaimed land. Of all the civilizations rising in pre-Roman Italy, the Etruscans stand out as the most brilliant, innovative, and creative. Legend says they emerged somewhere between 900 and 500 years before Christ in the area of Etruria and on the Po Plain. It is likely this was not just the result of the arrival of a foreign people, but also an evolution in the way of life as the migratory tribes who had arrived merged and married with those already there. The Etruscans traded with the Greeks, and their passion for Greek art was so great, it is said the tombs of Etruria have yielded more Greek vases than at Greece itself. Religion shaped their civilization, and at the height of their power they controlled 15,000 square miles stretching to the Bay of Naples. They gradually formed a confederation of 12 cities that included Rome. The Romans gave them the name Etruscan, Etrusci, or Tusci, while the Etruscans called themselves the Ricina, and the Greeks called them Tyrosinoi, rendered in English as Tyrrhenian, which is the name of the sea to the west of the Italian peninsula, where they may have come from originally. During their most prosperous period, the Etruscans hunted fish, dined and wined, and enjoyed chariot racing, all leisure activities of an exuberant civilized life, and their men and women were considered equal, depicted smiling even in death. The first tradesmen's guilds were founded in the age of the Etruscan kings, and its members became famous for producing superb bronze sculptures, gold and silver objects, and engraving gems, which they traded around the Mediterranean world. The sheer beauty and quality of the gold objects made in Etruria, 7 and 6 centuries before Christ, has never really been surpassed. Their skill at a technique for manufacturing gold objects, known as granulation, was considerable. The technique was difficult. It was necessary to first produce tiny pellets of gold, and using a copper solution mixed with vegetable or fish glue, diluted with water, apply them in selected patterns onto the object. Copper has a lower melting point than gold when heated, and it enabled them to join the pellets to their background without melting them. According to tradition, 7 Etruscan kings ruled Rome between the foundation of the city and the revolution by the Romans, who in 509 BC overthrew them and established a republic based on a Greek Ionian model. After that, the Etruscans gradually lost their cultural identity as they were absorbed into the Romanization of a huge geographical area we now know as Italy. By the beginning of the 3rd century before Christ, Rome was already a precinct of power and glory in Italy, and the encounter between the Roman world and the Greek Hellenistic art through Greek colonists in the south and the Etruscans in the north had gradually brought about an appreciation of beauty as an end in itself. By 133 years before Christ, the Romans, having defeated all their enemies, had become the most dominant force in the Mediterranean, and the city of Rome, a rival of Antioch and Alexandria, as the financial and political hub of the Mediterranean. From 91 to 88 years before Christ, Roman society vigorously debated what it meant to be a citizen of Rome. Politically, the debate was divided between two groups: the optimates, who defended the interests of an upper class, and the populares, who advocated reform for the greater good. From 60 to 49 years before Christ, a struggle for power played out against a backdrop of a senate of powerful men whose factions were all trying to gain control for their preferred leader. It eventually came down to a choice of 3 of its most prominent citizens and successful military leaders, who initially formed an unlikely alliance to try and govern together. As in all such struggles, it led to a standoff, and to resolve the issue, one of the preferred, Gaius Julius Caesar, began a civil war 49 years before Christ, knowing that if he won, he would become undisputed leader of the Roman world. Caesar came, saw, and conquered, and after it was over, set about bringing order from chaos, enacting extensive reforms, emboldening others. The Senate gave him the title Dictator Perpetuo, ruler for life, and he set about great public works, extending the Forum Romanum on the south side of the Palatine Hill, the site of Rome's earliest settlement. The Forum was marked by freestanding commemorative arches at its east and west end. Today, very little is left, because when migratory peoples overran the city centuries later, the columns and other architectural elements were reclaimed and used to build churches and other new buildings. The Ides of March, March the 15th, 44 years before Christ, marks the untimely murder of Julius Caesar, brought about by those intent on reversing the status quo. At his death, his prestige and support by the people of Rome and Italy was established. His plans to restore freedom of political life in the Republic and leadership to the Senate were already in motion, and it was not long before those who murdered him realized they had miscalculated. His vision for re-establishing Rome's traditional values would be brought to fruition under the guidance of his nominated heir, Gaius Julius Caesar Octavianus, who at the time of Caesar's assassination was a student in Apollonia. Rome's authority depended on the strength of its legions, and it would be under a force of arms its economic and cultural power would finally be achieved. At the Battle of Actium, 31 years before Christ, as if to prove his worthiness, Octavianus was called upon to defeat his brother-in-law Mark Antony, along with Egypt's Queen Cleopatra. The struggle for the successor to Caesar ended, and the imperial age began, by Octavian bringing about political unity in the Roman world. He adopted the title Princeps, which means first, as he regarded himself as the first among equals. The Senate, however, had other ideas and gave him the title Augustus, meaning sacred, venerable, a title from the Roman religious vocabulary that symbolized his exceptional role as an imperator or emperor. As its priest, too, he was also required to defend the faith of his people. During the reign of Augustus, 31 years before Christ to 14 years after Christ, Rome emerged as an economically successful city with a population approaching 1 million. To become a free citizen of Rome was considered a great honour. Whoever you were, if you were born within the boundaries of the Roman Empire, you had the right to hold the highest office in the state. A statesman of consummate skill, Augustus legislated to mould the fabric of Roman society. Some saw his leadership as a return to a mythical golden age, one where there would be a place for everyone. Every Roman citizen was now able to devote himself to the creation of a better world by participating in public works on a grand scale. The Forum, centre of the city's public life for centuries, was revitalised and renewed, with splendid buildings, triumphal arches, columns, statues, all resplendent in rare marbles and gilded bronze. Trees framed temples, civic buildings and amphitheatres, and gardens provided essential shade and a place for repose, becoming an integral part of town planning. Augustus brought about, with considerable skill, the difficult transition from republic to empire, transforming Rome into an imperial capital by providing the Roman world with exceptional administration and services. He made the Senate an important part of government, advanced men on merit rather than class, which was a complete change from the former republic. He put in place institutions that dealt with law and order, including the police and fire brigade. He divided the city into regions and wards, administered locally through its own elected magister or mayor. Food distribution was regulated, and he set up institutions to look after taxes, the water supply, to supervise public buildings, to look after the road system, and to provide protection from flooding of the Tiber River. He exercised tact and good sense to win cooperation and set a pattern of procedure and processes in place for his successors to take forward. He guided by suggestion, not command, and gave a lead when his advice was sought. Augustus empowered others, treating people with dignity and respect so that everyone's self-esteem remained intact. Today, we would admire him as an ultimate professional. His systems, once established, were put in place in other towns throughout Italy and also other countries as Rome's influence spread widely and everyone became prosperous under centralized Roman rule. In the account of his own accomplishments, he placed side by side two concepts reflected in the design of Roman architecture: that of auctoritas, or inner weight, the authentic and the exemplary, and potestas, the powerful and authoritative. A building with auctoritas had dignity, validity and authority, and the use of marble in buildings like temples led to evolving designs very different from those of a previous age. Greek architecture had striven for physical perfection in its form, evidenced in the Parthenon at Athens. Roman architecture, on the other hand, was distinguished by its unmistakable relationship to the space it occupied. By raising public buildings onto a podium as if it was a natural acropolis, Architects gave a defined direction, perception of influence and grandeur to their buildings. One of the most perfectly preserved temples in the former territory, ruled by Rome at the height of empire, is at Nîmes in France. It originally stood in the square on its own, visible from all sides. It is a building in which architecture of the Augustan period achieved its purest expression. Broad steps led up to the temple, cut into the front of a high podium, with the two top steps acting as a kind of threshold below the cella or the main body of the temple. The depth of its portico is equal to the width of the cella itself, which was a rectangular room occupying the whole width of the temple, receiving its light through the main door alone. A sense of order is projected by the regularity of the arrangement of the columns supporting the roof and the symmetry of the work itself. The governor of Richmond in Virginia, Thomas Jefferson, visited Nîmes in 1788 and was so impressed, it inspired his design for the Virginia state capital. First century Roman architect Marcus Pollio Vitruvius stated that order, arrangement, eurythmy, symmetry, propriety, and economy were the most important principles of architecture, and that in life, architecture should take a lead for its format from the measurements of the human body and the relationship and scale of each part of it to the whole. We know that in nature, order is important because it provides a framework for us to experience the world and survive in it. Vitruvius' architectural treatise is dedicated to Augustus. It is the only work of its kind surviving from antiquity. It is an insightful exposé of life and beliefs at that time and offered much valuable information to the world, including the recipe for concrete, when it was found by Italian historian Poggio Bracciolani in 1410. Renaissance man Leonardo da Vinci's famous Vitruvian Man symbolizes the blend of art and science when he relates the human body to the sphere, a shape that appears in nature, and to the square, which is not a natural shape, but a human invention. Perhaps the most recognisable of all Roman architectural inventions is the triumphal arch. Few empires have ever devised a more instantly recognisable symbol. Augustus set a fashion for building them so that Roman generals and consuls returning from the limits of the empire could enact a triumphant return to Rome along a sacred way, and the whole population could turn out to cheer them on. He faced them with Pentelic marble, and the Arch of Titus in the Via Sacra was the first to adopt a new composite capital in the orders of architecture, one distinctly Roman, whose form gathered the acanthus leaves from the Greek Corinthian order and combined them with the diagonal volutes of the Greek Ionic order. The Composite Order and the Tuscan Order, developed by the Etruscans, which interestingly enough is similar to those at Knossos, now added to the original three Greek orders of architecture, meant there were now five distinct orders that could be used, and they all reflected different cultures, ideas, and ideals. During the Augustan era, the desire to impose formal shapes and plans for architecture went hand in hand with a desire to order gardens as well. As water supplies were improved by the construction of great aqueducts carrying water from the country to the city, great baths could also be built and gardens established. At the baths of Caracalla, 1,600 people enjoyed amenities that included saunas, libraries, lounges, and a variety of bathing rooms, all with differing water temperatures. A ready water supply meant a cultivation of ornamental plants, and the meeting of Greece and Italy produced a vigorous new tradition, Ars Toporeia, the art of topiary. It became the rage, and author, naturalist, and natural philosopher Pliny the Elder referred to cypress trees being cut into a tableau of hunt scenes, fleets of ships, and all sorts of imagery. Flora was the goddess who reigned over all the flowers of the garden and cultivated fields. She was mostly portrayed as a maiden, clothed in diaphanous fluttering robes, woven with a pattern of flowers. She is captured carrying flowers in her arms, which she scattered wherever she went, while sweetly perfumed blooms fell from her hair at every movement. Now with the earth, its clear divisions marked, as with a comb shining from squalor free, shall claim her seeds, 'tis time to paint the earth with varied flowers, like stars brought down from heaven, white snowdrops and the yellow shining of marigolds and fair narcissus blooms. With fierce lines, gaping mouths, and the white cups of blooming lilies, and the corn flag bloom, snow white or blue. Then let the violet be planted, which lies pale upon the ground, or blooms with gold and purple blossoms crowned. Likewise the rose, too full of maiden blush. The Romans were probably the most lavish celebrants of the rose. On feast days, they scattered rose blossoms throughout the streets. Heliogabalus, a wealthy citizen, strewed rose petals over the couches, porticos, and grounds of his palace, and scented the air with fountains of rose water when entertaining. The seashore near Naples was strewn with roses when the emperor visited, and Roman heroes were glorified with crowns and garlands of roses. When they were out of season in Italy, they imported them from North Africa and purchased rose scents from Arab and India perfume merchants. The Roman instinct for seeing divinity in nature is beautifully expressed in a sculptural relief on the Areopagus or Altar of Peace at Rome. Earth is represented as a mature, graceful mother, nursing the mythical twins Romulus and Remus, who are said to have founded Rome, on her knee. This important monument was dedicated to Augustus by the Senate 13 years before Christ and was covered in magnificent sculptural decoration, both inside and out. It included a celebratory procession depicting Augustus and members of the imperial family, all happy and relaxed, celebrating his achievements. A symbol of the Augustan age, it exalted Rome's universal dominion, divine origin, and represented the peace imposed, the Pax Romana. It wasn't until 1937 that its various pieces, collected since the middle of the 16th century, were once again reunited in a building near the Mausoleum of Augustus, which still stands beside the Tiber, albeit the worse for wear. The Roman cameo technique is one of the most intriguing developments of ancient times. It meant carving back rock crystal, sardonyx, agate, and the more modest glass paste to produce a pictorial sculptural relief. Subjects range from portraits to portrayals of deities and mythological episodes, and they became more common during the early imperial age, and the fashion was very much widespread by the end of the first century. There is a cameo, which was probably part of a bigger one, depicting Augustus wearing a sword belt symbolising his military authority. We know this because it's embellished with a portrait of Minerva, who, like her Greek counterpart Athena, was goddess of war. The jewelled headband was added later, probably as an act of respect, honouring his achievements. The largest ancient Roman cameo which has survived is engraved in 24 layers. It is a marvellous piece of propaganda to assert the continuity and dynastic legitimacy of the Julio-Claudian dynasty of Augustus. He is depicted with his wife and her sons, the current Emperor Tiberius, who is seated in the centre, as well as Tiberius's heir, Nero Drusus. In ancient Rome, wealthy citizens collected carved gems and cameos, which were highly prized due to the skill required to create them, and they were considered among the most popular of luxury goods. Aristotle had said it is injustice that the ordering of society is centered. One of the most important cultural legacies of the Roman world was its legal system. Their sheer genius for organisation and planning is demonstrated in the Lex Romana, a system of laws from which the subsequent legal codes of the Western world derive. Roman law began as an ancestral custom which owed its force to religious sanctions. When the Romans came into contact with other nations, the sanctity which surrounded their ancient legal forms was relaxed and a new conception arose, that of the ius gentium. This was a law of all nations, a set of fundamental principles thought to be held in common by all people, regardless of creed, colour, or culture. Allied to it was the Stoic notion of natural law, whereby nature was assumed to favour simplicity and individual equality, an idea from Hellenistic Greece. In the Augustan age, jurists insisted the spirit of the law should always prevail over the letter of the law, which should always be interpreted in a benevolent manner. This attitude towards an individual and their rights is at the essence of the legal system established at Rome and at the heart of the Western justice system today. Under Augustus, the concept of an eternal Rome emerged, revealing its link to the legendary past and its promise of a new era. In Augustan Rome, public models of propriety were a meaningful aspect of society and the life of the state. It was hard work and efficiency that brought people to notice, and no one, no matter what their connections, could stand outside the law. This became evident to everyone when Augustus banished his own daughter Julia from Rome because of her notoriously dissolute and extravagant behaviour. The most famous image of Augustus we have is in his military aspect, and it was found in the remains of the house he lived in at Prima Porta with his strong-willed wife Livia. It shows him at the peak of his strength, wearing the commander's breastplate, whose relief sculptures allegorically represent his feet of arms. On his shoulder is the Sphinx, his personal seal. In the centre were the Parthian standards, lost by the Roman general Crassus and recovered by Augustus in diplomatic negotiation with the king of Parthia. The sun represents the new day which dawned for Rome when Augustus became its leader. This image set his personal style, for that of being a restorative figure above all else, and the statue is a great piece of propaganda. It dominated the space it stood in, and when you compare the feat to that of a statue of a Greek youth walking forward, you will see that the emperor remains still. The right foot supports him, a device that strengthens our perception of his coming to a halt, to command what lies before him, and that he will challenge all those who enter his arena.